We're being recorded and broadcast as well at the moment. I've mentioned to members about mobile devices and making sure that they're kept clear of the microphones. In terms of apologies today, we have an apology from Christopher Stalford. Everybody else except George is here, and hopefully when he joins us in Spotlight we'll see him, and if he needs to ask questions he can. Item 2 is the draft minutes. There was a meeting held on the 16th of September, and those minutes are page 5 of the meeting pack. Are members content that the minutes are a true reflection of the proceedings of the meeting?
Yep.
Okay, so we have those signed. There are no matters arising, which will allow us to move straight into the Brexit, to the oral evidence session with the junior ministers on Brexit issues. Members, in page 11 of the meeting pack, I would ask you also to look at page 3 of the tabled pack for the departmental briefing that was received late, but it was circulated to members on Friday evening. Also included in the tabled papers at page 9 is correspondence from the department notifying the committee that an extraordinary meeting of the EU-UK Joint Committee took place on the 10th of September. We appreciate that it was all very last minute and there wasn't time to give advance notice, but we are being told about the meeting 12 days after it happened. At page 10 is a note of the executive's action at the JMC EN meeting that took place on the 16th of July. It's taken over 2 months to be told that that has happened. And at page 14 is a note of the executive's action at the JMC EN meeting held on the 3rd of September. At page 18 is a copy of correspondence from the Welsh Legislation, Justice and Constitution Committee to the Secretary of State for Wales seeking clarity around the Sewell Convention and the UK Internal Market Bill. Would members agree maybe if we ask them for a copy of the response that they get? Yep. Okay. Okay. Members, Junior Minister Kearney and Junior Minister Lyons are in attendance today to brief us on the Brexit issue and to answer questions. Ministers, you're very welcome to the meeting today. Just again that you've been recorded and it's on Hansard. Maybe just to pass over to yourselves and let you give us an update, and then we'll let members ask questions.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Chairman, I'm glad to be able to be here again today in front of the committee. We last briefed the committee on the 24th of June. I believe you had officials before you on the 29th of July, and we are happy to provide a monthly update on EU exit matters as we resolved to do at the last meeting. Additionally, I believe that officials are scheduled to provide a briefing on common frameworks on the 7th of October, and the First and Deputy First Ministers will also be there at that day to provide an update on departmental issues more generally. We understand the committee has also requested specific briefing on issues associated with EU exit, and we're working to agree a schedule of dates so that we can meet that request. You will obviously have received our briefing paper ahead of today's meeting, and we intend to update you on progress made over the last number of weeks on a range of areas in relation to EU exit. So let me start by providing an update on the meetings of the Joint Committee and Specialised Committee since our last committee appearance. We'll also touch on the Internal Market Bill and the Northern Ireland Protocol. As you will have been aware and have been made aware, an extraordinary meeting of the Joint Committee took place on the 10th of September. The meeting was requested by the European Commission to seek clarifications from the UK on the full and timely implementation of the withdrawal agreement, including the protocol, following the publication of the UK Internal Market Bill the day before. The meeting was chaired jointly by the Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster, the Right Honourable Michael Gove, and European Commission Vice President Maros Sefcovic. All 27 EU member states were present, and both the First and Deputy First Minister joined the meeting by teleconference. During the meeting, both sides stated their positions, with the EU side requesting that the UK should withdraw the internal market proposals, and the UK underlining that they were fully committed to the implementation of the protocol and the technical discussions that we're seeking to resolve the issues. The EU representatives were to report back to the Commission President, the European Parliament and Member States, and committed to come back to members of the Joint Committee in due course. We understand that there has since been correspondence from Maros Sefcovic to Michael Gove asking that the UK withdraw certain articles from the UK Internal Market Bill, which the EU considers to breach the substantive provisions of the protocol, and they want that done before the end of September. The next scheduled meeting of the Joint Committee is due to take place on Monday, the 28th of September, and at present we do not have details of an agreed agenda, but we expect it to cover all the outstanding issues relating to the withdrawal agreement, including an update on implementation of the protocol, the other protocols to the withdrawal agreement, such as relating to Gibraltar, and on technical discussions between the two sides. In regards to the specialised committee, there has not yet been a meeting of the Ireland-Northern Ireland Specialised Committee since before the summer, and the timing of the next meeting will depend on progress at the technical level. In relation to the Internal Market Bill, the UK Government consulted on its UK Internal Market proposals in July and August. The Executive considered the proposals and issued an agreed response to the internal market consultation on the 12th of August, prior to the introduction of the Bill to Parliament in September. The Executive believes strongly that our vitally important relationship with the markets of England, Scotland and Wales must be protected for the benefit of our businesses and consumers, and that the proposals to legislate would be one of the most important determinants of our business market access for years to come. And this position was reflected in the Executive's consultation response. You will be aware that the introduction of the Bill has proved contentious, given the provisions within the Bill to give UK ministers powers to amend how the UK could implement the protocol. Key decisions are not reached with the EU through the Joint Committee. It will be important for the Executive to consider all aspects of the Bill, and in particular its impact on its devolved responsibilities. In relation to the protocol, clarity on the implementation of the protocol and the impact on our businesses and citizens remains the top cross-cutting priority issue for us. Our priority remains to secure unfettered access for Northern Ireland goods to the GP market, as well as the minimum possible friction on east-to-west movement of goods. Access to the GB market remains a vital economic interest to our businesses, and we continue to press the UK Government to ensure their commitment in the command paper is delivered to support current trade and the future strength of our economy. The UK Government published NI Business Guidance in August, which was an important step forward. However, as the UK Government recognised in the guidance, there are outstanding issues on which discussion is ongoing. We continue to press the UK Government for clarity on these issues, including any confusion for businesses. The Trader Support Service announced by the UK Government in August will be a valuable support to businesses, and we would encourage our businesses to avail of this service. We are all aware that our businesses and our economy face many pressures associated with the COVID-19 pandemic. Uncertainty around implementation of the protocol and its interaction with the outcome of the negotiations is causing added pressure and anxiety. We are therefore extremely concerned about business readiness for the end of the transition period, and that the limited time businesses will have to prepare will not be adequate, which will likely result in a further negative impact on our economy. And so we continue to press the UK Government for progress to address the uncertainty for our businesses and indeed our citizens. I hope that's been of some help. I'll hand over now to Declan, who will continue on other issues.
Thank you, Gordon, and thanks, Colin. So in my remarks, I'm going to cover the executive consideration of EU exit matters, operational readiness, negotiations, the JMC for European negotiations, EU exit-related legislation, and then the rights and the dedicated mechanism issues. The Executive Committee dealing with EU exit matters continues to meet each week. Recent discussions at the meetings have covered topics such as data exchange, EU programme participation, Peace Plus, and open and fair competition, as well as regular updates on stakeholder engagement and the progress of negotiations and the JMC EN meetings themselves. As Gordon referred to, we've agreed a response and issued to to the consultation on the Internal Market Bill, and we've since, as an executive, discussed the implications of the bill following publication. We've also discussed the issue of points of entry in order to fulfil the obligations set out in the protocol. We are, of course, in agreement on the need to secure the best outcome for the North and on the need to ensure goods can legally enter the North on the 1st of January 2021. The Department for Agriculture, Environment and Rural Affairs has since commenced the procurement process for points of entry. Negotiations on the future relationship between the British Government and the EU continued over the summer, with the most recent formal negotiating round concluding on the 12th of September. And the final negotiation round will take place in Brussels in the week commencing the 28th of October. We understand that the negotiation teams have continued informal discussions in the interim. You will be aware from the statements on both sides that significant areas of divergence remain, and these relate specifically to open and fair competition, fisheries, subsidy control or state aid, and that these gaps are going to be difficult to bridge without a political intervention. Boris Johnson has stated his aim of completing the negotiations by the middle of October in order to allow for ratification by the October Council, that is at the end of October itself. Whilst we welcome the continued commitment from both negotiation teams to reach an agreement on the future relationship, negotiations which stretch beyond this point are going to have an inevitable impact on the time available to prepare for either a deal or a no-deal outcome. As has been the case throughout the negotiations, responsibility for concluding this agreement lies within the competence of the British Government, and we have shared that assessment with the committee in the past. The Executive continues to take every opportunity to engage with the British Government and the Task Force Europe negotiators to ensure that the future relationship which we will have best reflects the interests of our people, our businesses and our regional and our island economy. Indeed, the Deputy First Minister and Gordon himself and myself reiterated that very point to the EU Ambassador to Britain when we met together last Thursday. The Joint Heads of Government also wrote to Michael Gove on the 10th of September. He emphasised the critical importance of rules of origin in these negotiations and their potential impact on our economy. So we continue to press on the impact of interdependencies between the negotiations, on the future relationship with the EU, and of course in relation to the implementation, the full implementation of the protocol. There is a huge potential for negative consequences, albeit unintended, for our people and our businesses if there is not a joined-up approach achieved. Since our last appearance at this committee, there have also been two meetings of the JMC for European negotiations, and those took place on the 16th of July and the 3rd of September. And Gordon and I accompanied both heads of government to both of those meetings. The agendas have included negotiations with the EU, updates on transition readiness, including the legislative timetable and implementation of the protocol, as well as progress on work on the UK common frameworks. At the most recent meeting on the 3rd of September, two frameworks received provisional confirmation by the JMC, and they related to hazardous substances, planning and nutrition, health claims, and also composition and labelling. And those frameworks will now move to scrutiny here by the relevant Assembly Committee and in other legislatures in Wales and in Scotland. The main points we made at the meeting on the 3rd of September included concerns about the limited time available for an agreement on the future relationship to be concluded, ratified and then implemented before the end of the transition period at the end of this year. We also addressed the need for political intervention to reach an agreement and the need to take into account the interactions between the negotiations on the future relationship and the protocol itself, particularly in specific key areas such as SPS checks. We understand that officials, as Gordon said earlier, will be providing a specific briefing to the committee on the Common Frameworks Programme on the 7th of October, and they'll be in a position to provide further detail at that session. As we informed you at our last appearance, the Executive are undertaking operational readiness planning, which do include the option of a non-negotiated outcome. I know this committee has discussed before the implications of a non-negotiated outcome in general, and in particular in regard to how protocol would work in practice with other arrangements such as WTO trading rules. It is worth noting that whatever the outcome of the current negotiations, the protocol will still come into force on the 1st of January 2021. We have some degree of certainty on that regard, but of course the impact of a no-deal outcome would still be very significant for us all. In a non-negotiated outcome, it will be important to understand where mitigations lie that sit within our competence and where they are within the competence of the British Government. And this will be considered as part of our planning for a non-negotiated outcome. It is vital that we prepare on a collaborative basis with the British Government, given the short timescale available until the end of the transition period. To facilitate that, the British Government has agreed that our officials will be involved in all future meetings of the UK Transition Period Readiness Portfolio Board, and we welcome that development. We also welcome the recent correspondence between the British Government Permanent Secretaries and our NICS counterparts on reciprocal information sharing in relation to operational readiness. That increased engagement with the British Government will go some way to help in aligning our energy and resources to resolve as many issues as possible in the short timescale available, and to ensure that we have as sound a risk-informed planning and prioritisation process as possible. We have emphasised to the British Government that it is essential that there is substantial and substantive engagement at both a ministerial and an official level. Ministers will continue to be involved in regular quadrilateral meetings with the Paymaster General, Penny Mordaunt, and with other devolved administrations from Scotland and Wales, which will consider operational readiness issues. Legislation is also a key area in preparing for both the implementation of the protocol and the future relationship, or in the event of a non-negotiated outcome, for operational readiness. We have a very significant challenge ahead of us all to effect a high volume of largely technical EU exit legislation before the end of the transition period on the 31st of December this year. And work is ongoing to capture the volume of legislation which is likely to be required to do that. It will be necessary to manage this alongside the essential mainstream business of the Assembly, including non-EU exit legislative programmes. Our officials are also liaising with Assembly officials to ensure that Assembly committees are involved in a timely and appropriate manner in progressing that legislation. The Executive Office at this time has not identified any legislation to be brought forward under the EU exit legislative programme. The Equality Commission and the Human Rights Commission have been asked by the Treasury to undertake a scrutiny and monitoring role that will form what we've been describing as the dedicated mechanism. And that will ensure that our people are not subject to a diminution on rights, safeguards, or equality of opportunity following Britain's exit from the EU. The Executive Office, a sponsor for the Equality Commission, has been involved in discussions that have taken place around appropriate funding for the Commission to discharge that function. And the Commission has formally agreed that it is indeed willing to act as part of the dedicated mechanism, and that it will proceed to establish the dedicated mechanism itself. And I touched on that in my last report to the committee. So, Colin, I hope that those updates have been useful for now.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Yes, we appreciate getting that information, and thank you for presenting that. I'll begin with you mentioned a number of times in both presentations about the potential for a non-negotiated outcome or no-deal scenario. Could you give us a flavour of the preparation that there is within the Executive Office for a no-deal scenario, given that we're 99 days now, as I understand, from the end of the process, and there is currently no deal and very little prospect of a deal, given many of the events over the last 2 weeks. So, I mean, can you give me a flavour? Do you have a special department within the Executive Office that's preparing for a no deal? Do you have a special committee that meets on a regular basis? Who's involved in that process, and what preparations are being taken for the disaster of a no deal outcome?
Well, look, I do think it is important, first of all, to say that that's not where any of us want to be, and I know that's not where you want to be either. I think it was always going to be the case that negotiations would go down to the wire. I certainly hope that we can get an outcome, because that's what's best for Northern Ireland, to ensure that we have that agreement. We obviously meet regularly. We have the EU Exit Committee that meets every week as the executive body that's looking at this. And of course, all scenarios are going to be taken into consideration. We also have the liaison with the government in London, ensuring that we have the most updated information that we would need as well under all of those scenarios. So it's not something that we're looking towards. It's not something that we want to see happen, but work obviously is going on as part of that.
Okay, if I could just push a bit more on that. I mean, obviously, you know, we had nearly a 15-minute report from yourselves and all the efforts and the thousands of people that there must be that are involved in preparing us towards a deal, but it's still only a 50-50 at best outcome. The other side is a no deal. And obviously the implications of a no deal upon businesses and upon communities and upon those that travel back and forward across the border, upon the business that comes in and out through freights. We've heard about all the problems that there is in preparing for a deal, but is there an actual committee? Is there actually a group of people that are actively saying this is what we do if there's a no deal scenario, and working, sort of wargaming what those solutions would be, given that they may be the rules that businesses here have to follow in 99 days' time?
Yeah, sure. There is a unit within TEO, which is headed up by Andrew McCormick, which is specifically responsible on the official side for dealing with negotiations. They participate in the specialised committee. They observe the joint committee meetings. They're engaged directly with British officials on an ongoing basis, and in and around, before and after the quadrilateral meetings that are convened by Penny Mordaunt. Suffice to say, we are probably now in a perfect storm. Our officials are clearly cited on the prospect of there being a no-deal outcome. But even in the event of there being an agreed outcome, we are still some distance away from actually getting clarity and certainty in relation to the issues that are extant. So, just to give you a flavour of the pinch points in relation to this, at this particular point in time, there is divergence in the negotiations over rules of origin and in relation to fisheries and state aid. The Joint Committee has been mandated to address the issue of tariffs before the end of the transition period, the issue of tariffs, fisheries and aquaculture, the question of EU representatives in relation to the observation of customs and regulatory inspections, and also exemptions for agricultural state aid. None of those issues have been closed out. It is further complicated by the reality, which I touched on in my remarks, that there is an interdependency in relation to those outstanding issues of negotiation within how the protocol is going to be implemented. And now the Internal Market Bill brings in huge ramifications for the current state of process. That is, we have not yet arrived at a point where we can be sure if there's going to be an agreed deal. On the other hand, the door is open to the prospect of there being a no-deal outcome. At a meeting earlier in September, I noted the report given by David Frost, and I observed afterwards in meetings with colleagues from Scotland and Wales and the British government that in fact what we were hearing were the acoustics for both a crash out situation and non-crash out. But the difficulty, to come back to points that we've made in the past, is that we are not directly involved in the specificity of those negotiations. We press for additional information. We press for information from the British government in relation to their planning assumptions, both in terms of there being an outcome, but more importantly in relation to no outcome. And the reason I summarised those issues, which are points of divergence where there is disagreement, and they include now state aid, the question of the free flow of data, issues in relation to transport, that gives you some sense of the complexity of actually trying to prepare adequately for the prospect of a non-deal outcome. So we are sighted on that prospect, but we are only in a position to manage that prospect within our own competence. And at this point in time, and I know it will not satisfy the committee to hear this again, we are still not sufficiently engaged in relation to the detail of the negotiations that would allow the executive and our officials to say that we are sufficiently involved and that we have clarity about the direction of travel in relation to these negotiations.
Okay, but again, to make the point, because as you've said, the door is open to a no-deal outcome. But I put it to you that if you look into that room, there's no TEO officials in that room preparing for that outcome. And much of what you have said back is about the complexities in preparing for an outcome. And I'm hearing what you're saying, that our engagement isn't to the highest standards in terms of preparing for an outcome. But surely somebody, somewhere within the Executive Office has said there's a fairly high chance here that we could have a no-deal outcome, and we know what the ramifications are. We'd have known 2 years ago what the ramifications of a no-deal outcome would be. So has anybody within the Executive Office said, do you know what, can we put a few people in their room and start sketching out what would be required for a no-deal scenario so that we can help people prepare for that?
I would just say I think it's unfair to say that there is nobody that is dealing with this, and if that's the impression that we've given you, that's wrong. First of all, because we do look at all of these scenarios, and obviously then there are officials that we'll look at the non-negotiated outcome scenario as well. Additionally, there was an awful lot of work done a year ago in anticipation for the possibility of no agreement at the end of 2019. The hub was established that was dealing with that within the wider civil service. That has the ability to be stood up again when necessary. So I don't have maybe some of the specific detail that you're looking for, Mr. Chairman, but if I can get that to you, I'd be more than happy to pass that on.
Well, look, I think we have officials coming next week that are going to give us a presentation about contingency planning, which will include for a no-deal scenario. Can I suggest that you suggest to them that they're well-versed and well-ready to give us answers on those preparations, and that will be very useful. Ministers, the Future EU Relations Committee in Westminster has been meeting with the devolved regions to listen to the issues that they're having with Brexit and to take on board their views. I understand both Scotland and Wales met with that committee in Westminster on the 15th of September. Now, the Executive Office was invited, but I understand that you haven't responded yet to that invitation. It's an open invitation, as I understand, as well. Would it be your intention, given that the other devolved regions have sort of accepted the invitation in good spirit and went along to discuss the issues, would there be any opportunity for the views of the executive to be relayed at those?
Certainly have no objection to that, Mr. Chairman. Happy to share our experience in engaging with the government on this issue, no problem at all.
Okay, well, I think you have an invite within the department that was, I think the aim was they were looking to have the three devolved regions there at the one meeting, but the impression seems to be that there's a difficulty securing an answer from yourselves. I think that would be incredibly important, but we've missed the boat in the three regions coming together to give that, but I'm sure meet with yourselves if you were able to to get to that invite.
And they would be very clear, Colin, on the message that we'd be bringing, because there's a regular continuous engagement on a quadrilateral basis between ourselves, our Scottish and our Welsh colleagues, along with specifically the mechanism that's in place with Penny Mordaunt, and then separate to that, an increased uptake in relation to engagement with Michael Gove and his people through the JMC itself.
As a good custodian of select committees and committees that are in legislators, I think if they were looking at an opportunity to meet with you, it would be nice for them to be able to get a flavour of what your thinking is to help inform their work in putting pressure on the government as well. Finally, then, you've maybe got some more additional time on your hands now that you have passed the responsibility for health regulations on and the amendments to that you would have taken responsibility for passage through the House has now gone to the Health Minister. So could we get a flavour maybe just from yourselves what your priorities are as junior ministers in terms of Brexit? Where do you see the most important work being in the 99 days ahead? What are the key areas that you are working towards?
Well, just let me say first, in terms of the health regulations, we were happy to take those through the Assembly on behalf of the Health Minister. They were obviously health regulations brought to the Executive, and we were happy to step in at that time and to help the Health Minister in that way. We've got to the stage now where there's an increasing workload, especially on officials within our department, and it's made it necessary for our officials to concentrate on that other work. Certainly, as far as we're concerned, Brexit isn't the only issue that we deal with, but certainly I would say the majority of the time that we would spend on Brexit-related issues would be in regards to engagement with the UK government. We do that regularly. We meet, as Declan has already outlined, in a number of formats, and we'll continue to do that. We also had the opportunity last week to meet with the EU ambassador to the UK, and you know we're not direct participants within these negotiations, although we do have the ability and we have gone along to joint committee meetings. But really, I see it certainly as my role, and I think Declan will share this as well. Look, we have a common purpose here, which is to secure the best outcome that we can for Northern Ireland. We understand the issues that are at play here, and we want to make sure that those who are negotiating are aware of our special circumstances that we're facing as a result of the withdrawal agreement and the protocol. So we want to make sure that the views of the people here in Northern Ireland are heard. We do that through engaging both with the government and where appropriate with the EU, and that's what we're going to continue to do. I'm sure Declan will want to add some.
Yes, that. And add to that also, in terms of engagements that were appropriate with the Irish government in the context of North-South engagements, our objective clearly is to find an agreed outcome to this negotiation, to the conclusion of the withdrawal agreement itself, that it will be fully implemented. That's our objective, but it is out with our competence, our authority to ensure that that happens. I think that we're dealing with a British government at this point in time that has probably set itself on a trajectory to see a non-agreed outcome, a crash-out Brexit. And in those circumstances, our function, our job must be to then ensure that the protocol, which will still come into force on the 1st of January 2021, is in fact fully implemented, and that the interests of our people, deal or no deal, continue to be protected, both in terms of the economy, businesses and the livelihoods of citizens who live here. So in terms of the bigger picture, those are the guiding objectives that we will be responsible for taking forward, both directly on behalf of the Executive and then deputising where appropriate on behalf of the Joint Heads of Government.
And Minister Kearney, I couldn't agree with you more. I think that sense of moving towards a no-deal outcome, I'm not entirely comforted by the answers that I've had from you, but I hope that that's maybe from being put on the spot rather than and not having the detail. But hopefully next week we will extract much more detail about the preparations that this executive is making for that outcome, because if it's a reality, what we don't want on the 1st or 2nd of January is the accusation that the executive was asleep at the wheel, too busy focusing on another outcome and not preparing for the one that could be hurtling towards us, because that would be certainly where we don't want to go.
That would certainly be a very unfortunate outcome, because it would reflect very badly on all five parties who are members of our power sharing coalition.
And the British government.
Of course.
I pass to the Vice... Oh, sorry.
And the EU.
And the EU. I'll pass to the Vice-Chair.
Thanks, Chair. Gordon Declan, thank you for that brief. It's really informative, and thank you for all of the work you're doing in regards to this. It's complex. It's high-end politics. It's international politics. And as you said, we are not sufficiently involved in that for whatever reasons. I don't know. And I've got a real concern that what we have is a game of football between Boris and Barnier, and Northern Ireland happens to be the football. And the concern is that somebody's going to push that nuclear button, and there's going to be a non-negotiated outcome. And I've got to say this, because it has to be on the record, I'm staggered that we do not have something somewhere, a committee of people whose sole purpose is to look at what a non-negotiated outcome will mean for us. Because even, Declan, if I take your own words, as you've said, that you believe the British government are intent on a non-negotiated outcome. So if we believe that they're intent on that, why are we not preparing for that? So I've got to say, I am concerned that we don't. I honestly thought you would sit there and say, yes, no problem, we've set a department aside, and they're looking at all of the upshot of what a non-negotiated outcome would be. So I've got to say, in echoing the Chair's point, I am concerned. I hope you can take that back to the Executive Office and say that we have a concern. Sorry.
No, sorry. I just think it's important for me to come in on this point. And sorry, before I do, actually, can I just say, Doug, to you personally, I'm very disappointed to hear about the threat that has been levelled against you. That's completely unacceptable and needs to be condemned by all right-thinking people, and I just didn't want to let this opportunity go without saying that. I do think, though, it is important just to clarify, I don't want any misinformation going out of here today. It's not the case that nothing is going on around this issue. I've already said this is an issue that is raised during, it's on our dashboard, the problems, the potential issues that we could face. Officials within the department have been dealing with this issue and the possibility of, first of all, a no deal at the end of 2019, and now what we may face at the end of 2020. I don't want to give the wrong impression here today that in any way this isn't being considered as an option and appropriate steps aren't being taken. I don't have the number of people. I don't have the further detail or data on that, but we are happy to give that to you, and no doubt the officials will be able to fill you in further on that.
And Gordon, can I just follow up on that, and thank you for your kind words, first of all, but can I just follow up on that, and I don't want you to think that I don't think yous are working on that either, because I think yous are. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is I honestly thought there would be a dedicated group which would be cross-departmental, you know, so that justice will be looking at what happens if there isn't negotiated. Health will be looking at it. Infrastructure will be looking at it. That's what I honestly thought we would be at now, especially since the Internal Market Bill has made everything so incredibly toxic, and we think that we are going to a non-negotiated outcome. So my deduction on that and my analysis on that is, as soon as somebody says that to me, I would be ramping up my preparations for a non-negotiated outcome, and that would include some form of a committee, some form of a working group, cross-departmental, to look at all of those issues. So I'm not saying you aren't working on it, Gordon, please, Declan, don't think I meant that. I'm just saying I thought we would have been ramping up what we would be doing.
What I can tell you just on that point, yep. Doug, is that in the aftermath of the civil contingencies structure being stood down, at an earlier stage, as we dealt with the need to deal with the health crisis, a review process was undertaken in relation to that structure. Its specific forward focus was on repurposing a structure based upon the civil contingencies model for the Brexit scenario. Whether that scenario was in context with a deal or the prospect of there being no deal. That review has been carried out. The report, I presume, is in the process of being drafted. It hasn't been brought forward yet, but it was about two broad objectives. assessing what worked within civil contingencies as we dealt with the complexity of the health crisis, and then what would be effective learning to be introduced to a new structure that would be cross-departmental, that would be interagency, to deal with the repercussions and the headwinds of whatever lies on the other side of the transition period.
And thanks, Declan. And interesting, it'd be interesting to see that, because when we didn't have an assembly here, there was also a civil contingency looking at a no-deal Brexit. So actually, what we had looking at a no-deal Brexit can nearly be transposed to looking at a non-negotiated.
Yes.
You know, it'd be interesting to see that report, I have to say, and as time ticks on quite rapidly, you know, it'd be really good to see that.
Well, arising from this discussion, I actually will go back to those who were responsible for overseeing the process, who carried out the interviews, who gathered the information, the data, and I will inquire for you as to where the drafting of that report is at, because its forward focus was on the Brexit situation.
And you can see that there's a real concern here. I mean, I'm concerned. It's not a blame, it's a concern. Because to say that they're gathering up all of the exit legislation that needs to be achieved before the transition period is over, yet Northern Ireland hasn't identified any exit legislation, nothing at all, nothing in the Executive Office, nothing in justice, nothing in health, nothing in infrastructure. We've identified no legislation that we have to amend before. Is that what we're saying?
No. There are three pieces of legislation that have been identified at this stage.
Okay, sorry.
So that would be an education bill, the health and social care cross-border healthcare bill, and the infrastructure omnibus bill. So those are three indicative, an indicative requirement for those three bills to be brought forward, to be completed during or as shortly afterwards as possible of the EU transition period.
And in addition to that, Stormont departments believe that there are 72 Assembly SRs, 13 of which have been laid, and 90 Westminster SIs, 21 of which have been laid, and 9 Westminster primary legislation, primary bills. So it's not that those haven't been identified, they certainly have. There may well be more that are to be identified.
And will they be the responsibility of this Assembly to work through these before the end of the year? Is that a chunky old bit of work, isn't it?
It is, and it's a very daunting prospect to expect that it would be done by the 31st of December. It's a very, very challenging workload that faces us in the midst of all of the uncertainty.
Yeah. And could I ask very briefly, thanks for your indulgence, Chair, could I just ask very briefly, I take it that there's no issue with some of this legislation happens after the transition period is over. We don't suddenly stop dead on the 31st of December. There is stuff that can follow up.
I think it's inevitable that there's going to be a carryover into 2021, Doug. That's unavoidable.
So we as an Assembly and as an Executive will still be doing Brexit in 2021?
We'll be dealing with the consequences of it, whatever arises.
Yeah, that's for sure. Thank you. And thank you, Chair.
Martina.
Thank you, Ministers, for your presentation. And a few questions. Minister Lyons, I come to you first,
okay.
If that's okay.
Yep.
Could I ask you if the Executive will be taking account of the two motions that went through the Assembly that were passed overwhelmingly Monday and Tuesday on upholding the protocol and rejecting the Internal Market Bill?
Well, obviously there is a difference of opinion within the Executive Office around the Internal Market Bill. Look, there are things that we're obviously united on. We obviously want to make sure that we can get the best outcome for Northern Ireland. We don't want to see any additional barriers to trade north-south or to east-west. And we are united on getting the best outcome for people here in Northern Ireland. Obviously, though, there is a difference of opinion in regards to the Internal Market Bill, and I think that was expressed in the debate. So that's our starting point, Ms. Anderson. We want to make sure that we're going to get the best deal here for people in Northern Ireland.
Minister Kearney, picking up on that, could you give us your blunt and honest analysis of the internal market, Bill?
There's no good Brexit, regardless of the outcome. As Gordon said, we have political differences in relation to leave and remain, but we are in fact united in relation to what's necessary to protect our economy, jobs, the livelihoods of citizens. We did have the option of an extension, despite representations from some of the parties here in relation to an extension being secured in June. The British government refused to ask for that. My own sense is that the British government at this point in time, with the introduction of the Internal Market Bill, is probably pressing one of the EU's most sensitive buttons. And what I mean by that is that it foresees the prospect of a post-Brexit Britain potentially becoming more agile, deregulated free market competitor, and with access to EU markets by using selective state aid. So there has been much punditry around the way this is shaping up. Some have talked about a game of chicken, a standoff between the British government and the EU. The British government has said emphatically that they're not going to blink. They said before that they weren't going to proceed with an application for extension. They've said that they won't blink, and that the EU doesn't actually grasp the gravity of that intent. And I think that that's what leads me to the consideration that we may well be dealing with elements, at least within this British government, that have the whip hand, who are prepared for a non-negotiated outcome. Boris Johnson has said that if there's nothing sorted out by the 15th of October, then nothing's going to be sorted out at all, because the clock is now ticking towards the 31st of October. Leaving the EU on the 31st of December without a deal, in my view, is going to have serious repercussions for jobs and for the local economy. I think that will be both regional and it will be for the island economy itself. I also happen to think that, I was reading a report on this morning by a study carried out under the auspices of the London School of Economics, that there could be serious repercussions for the economy in the British state itself. So that's why I say there is no good Brexit for any of us, regardless of how you come at this, remain or leave. But I do believe that the legislation itself is a very clear breach of international law. The Secretary of State indicated as much in his remarks, acknowledged that it does represent a departure from an international treaty, that it is a breach. And while some might say that the approach of the bill is nothing more than a negotiation ploy in itself to try and exert some additional leverage, and to squeeze Michel Barnier's approach in all of this, the reality is that it has provoked a huge outcry here in this state. It has provoked a huge outcry on the island. The reaction from the United States, with people like Nancy Pelosi and Richie Neal stating that if there is no deal and there is a threat to the Good Friday Agreement, as a consequence, there will be no British-US free trade treaty struck. And then I think it's notable to take up on the fact that elements within the British establishment, and in fact within the Tory party itself, have come out very, very forcefully to say this is a breach of international law, it has huge reputational damage for the British government, for the British state, and it should never have happened. Our colleagues in Scotland and Wales are describing it effectively as a full frontal assault on devolution, as a power grab. If you look at elements of the bill, such as Clause 49, when you drill down into it, it actually provides for amendments to our own 1998 Bill Act here in the North, the legislative basis of the Good Friday Agreement, and it also has implications for other devolved regions' statutes. And that effectively then creates a situation where the Internal Market Act would be firewalled away from any future amendment or judicial challenge. Now, that's a pretty stark and worrying situation. So, in short, I do have a view that the protocol itself is imperfect. It's not the finished article, but it is at least an insurance policy that gives us basic protections in relation to our peace agreement for political stability here, for the rights of citizens, for the island economy, and for the protection of jobs and livelihoods of our citizens here. But it has repercussions for the Good Friday Agreement, to be blunt in response to your point. And I do think that this is dangerous ground for the British Government to consider abandoning those safeguards and mitigations, whether or not it's a negotiation tactic. It's dangerous ground to get into when you start to mess with that level of political sensitivity and stability. I believe that Boris Johnson and some within his government have been negligent in their approach to the Good Friday Agreement. That's been a hallmark of every Tory government since 2010, negligence towards the agreement, oversight for the agreement. I think that the British government, to go back to something that Doug said earlier on, I actually think that this British government is now treating the North and the peace process and our power sharing arrangements here as a commodity in a bigger picture. I think that that's wrong, and what's really now at stake, to conclude, what's at stake in all of this is the political and the economic progress that we have enjoyed here on this island, in this region, and in terms of how it has improved relations between Britain and Ireland. I think all of that is potentially up in the air as a result of what has happened here.
And I suppose, Mr. Chairman, to answer that question, I take a very different view on the Internal Markets Bill. I actually believe that it is a step forward. I believe that it actually tries to, I think, first of all, recognises some of the damage that has been done by the withdrawal agreement and the protocol. I don't believe it's everything that we need, but I believe that it is a step forward compared to where we were previously. Because we all sit here and we all talk about how we want to make sure there are no issues north, south or east, west. But we don't have that certainly yet in terms of east, west. We need to make sure, considering that the rest of the UK is our biggest market, we need to make sure that there can be that free flow. We need to make sure that we can deal with issues such as the export declarations. We need to make sure that we can move our goods to the rest of the UK. I don't believe that that is a problem in terms of the command paper and what has already been set out. And in fact, it is in keeping with what the EU and others have already said that their objectives are. I think people have got themselves very excited about this bill. And we've heard an awful lot of scaremongering out there about how it affects the Good Friday Agreement. And I just want to put on record today that I think that it's absolutely wrong for people to do that. And I'm fed up of Northern Ireland being used as a pawn in all of the European negotiations. But it's been made worse by some people in regards to what they have said about the Good Friday Agreement, how it damages the Good Friday Agreement. I actually have a copy of the Good Friday Agreement here. It's not my own copy, Mr. Chairman, because I lent my own copy to the former Secretary of State, Julian Smith, during the talks process, and unfortunately he never gave it back to me. So next time he's here, maybe we could ask him about that.
He must be rereading it and enjoying it.
He must be, and I...
Good. That's a positive move for a British Secretary of State.
And I've been reading it as well, and it says that it would be wrong to make any change in the status of Northern Ireland save with the consent of a majority of its people. And I believe that that's what the protocol does. It's the protocol that goes against the Good Friday Agreement, not the Internal Markets Bill. In fact, what I think that what the Internal Markets Bill is trying to do is support what we find in Article 6 of the Act of Union, which is that free flow of goods and of trade between Northern Ireland and the rest of the UK. So we've all committed to making sure we have this free movement, north, south, and east, west. So what I think we need to do is take the heat out of all of this, take the hyperbole out of it all, and actually try and work together to get a deal that delivers for the people that we represent.
Well, Chair, you'll not be surprised to hear me say that I don't concur with that analysis, because the section that's just been read out from the Good Friday Agreement is the section that deals with the constitutional question, and that was the only area of the consent, the area of the principle of the consent was to apply. I think given that a lot of people, many in the international community, do regard the Internal Market Bill as putting us on, as the Minister has said, Minister Kearney, on dangerous ground, I think the step forward that you're talking about is taking us towards that cliff. And in 99 days' time, we are in danger of going over a cliff. And whatever plans you're looking for, Chair, I don't know how you plan for taking yourself out of the rubble, because that's what we're facing into. And this isn't scaremongering. You know, we've heard and been dismissed about all of that as we were heading out campaigning to remain in the EU. We were dismissed and told we were scaremongering. And unfortunately, Project Fear, as we were accused of, became Project Fact. So as we take in what's been said about the dangerous territory that we're on and where we're heading towards, could I ask, Minister Kearney, you had spoke about the border controls post, and you mentioned procurement briefly in your commentary. So could, given what has taken place from Minister Putz in relation to the implementation of the border control post, could you give us a further update as to where the implementation of the protocol or the procurement story is in relation to the border control post?
Yeah, well briefly, the executive has discussed the issue at length. The procurement process has commenced in relation to putting in place whatever infrastructure is required in fulfilment of the obligations flowing from the protocol.
So that's gone.
Yeah, I feel that we're getting things the wrong way round. You know, as part of the negotiations, what we should have done first was got the free trade agreement in place and then worked on the withdrawal agreement. And I think it's the same when it comes to what's taken place here. It's obviously right that we try and get that agreement first, and this is why it's so difficult for us to legislate, why it's so difficult for us to do some of the things that we might need to do, because we don't have an agreement yet. We don't know what an agreement is going to look like. We don't know what type of checks, if any, are going to be needed. So I think we just need to be very careful in terms of how we proceed on that issue. And just then to go back to the previous point that you had made about the Good Friday Agreement, I'm not a supporter or a defender of the Good Friday Agreement. I think my party's position on that is clear. But I would read to you the words of David Trimble, who had something to do with that agreement, when he said that the amazing and disturbing fact is that the withdrawal agreement, and in particular the Northern Ireland Protocol, totally undermine the central premise of the Good Friday Agreement. The whole purpose of the agreement was to give stability to Northern Ireland by embedding in this international accord a promise that it was up to the people of Northern Ireland to choose the constitutional status of the country. So I would just urge people to be very careful in regards to their language. I recognise that there's a difference of opinion in Northern Ireland on Brexit. I respect the fact that different people have taken a different view in regards to this. What I'm calling for is that we try to ensure that we do respect the constitutional status of this country, as all parties in here have agreed to, and I think that's very important as we move forward. But I'm sure, Mr. Chairman, you're not wanting to go any further on this at this time, but I thought it was important to put that on the record.
And of course, the constitutional question is laid out in the Good Friday Agreement, and it can be tested. Let's test it if everyone thinks that it's okay, if it's safe, and let's see, we'll let the people decide, but that's for another
day. Needs the consent of the people.
For another day.
Well, if I may just come in, so that we've got a bit of balance in relation to how we're receiving or filtering the issue of people's reaction to what has happened. The Lord Chief Justice, Declan Morgan, stated earlier in the last few days that Such a flagrant disregard for the rule of law will no doubt engender a quote-unquote domestic effect on the confidence that the public will have in our regional legal system. So there are many people who are commenting on the repercussions of this. I don't think that they are all coming at this from an ideological or from a partisan political perspective. And in recent days, a very significant consortium of civil society groups within the North, including the Committee on the Administration of Justice, have warned that the implementation of the Internal Market Act will have repercussions and consequences for the basis upon which our political process is established. And I think we have to take account of all of those views, notwithstanding the differences that we have as parties in relation to this situation. There is a bigger picture here, and I think that it would be foolhardy for us just to dismiss criticism of the Internal Market Bill, potentially to become an Internal Market Act, as simply being sabre-rattling or partisan or critical for the sake of being critical. And let's bear in mind, this has been in the making now since 2018. Boris Johnson picked up on a negotiation that was closed out by Theresa May. There's very little substantive material difference between what was in her original backstop and what is now what you might describe as being in his front stop. But, you know, once he's seen the ink dry in the paper, he's effectively now stepping back and saying, no, listen, boss, I'm not up for that anymore. So, you know, you can't take a pick and mix approach towards how you conduct international negotiations. You're either in for a penny or you're in for a pound. And the British government, this British government, is down this road 2 years and signed up to this. And I don't accept for a moment that Boris Johnson, Michael Gove, and others within that administration didn't know what they were signing on for.
Chair, I think it's important that maybe we would all realise you can't have a future relationship before you get a divorce. You can't say to somebody, I'm not going to divorce you unless you tell me what way you're going to treat me in the future. And that's what this was about. The withdrawal agreement was your divorce, and your future relationship is what you do afterwards. So you can't be saying, well, we should have had the future relationship sorted out first, and then we would work out how we're going to divorce one another. So I think what you've described there is the wrong way around. But what I'm concerned about also, we've heard a lot of talk, and we all are involved, and of course we're concerned about the custom union and the internal market, and whether it's the internal market bill and analysis of that. And we have cows and we have sheep and we have pigs across from one end of the border, and, you know, produced in one and processed in another. And we hear about all of those protections, but it's a non-diminution of rights. That's something that I think that we need to hear. How is the executive going to collectively ensure that that clause in the protocol, that there'd be no diminution of rights, given that we live in a place that won't even have a single equality bill, won't even have a bill of rights? And how are we going to protect, for instance, those people who live in your constituency and mine?
I thought you wanted the divorce first.
Order. Across this island.
Martin, I thought you wanted the divorce first.
And order.
For instance, I'm asking a question.
I thought you wanted the divorce first. Make your mind up what you want.
So, who cross this island, for instance, even in your own constituency.
What was the divorce you wanted? Get the divorce done. Your own words.
And is dependent on a dog. And a dog that maybe they work in one part of this jurisdiction and they live in another. So for instance, if they're crossing, if they're in Strabane and they have to cross the bridge, every time they cross the bridge, if you're talking about these rights not being upheld and protected and that there would be a diminution of our rights, they're going to have to go to the vet. And they're going to have to ensure that every time they cross from one side of this border to the or the other, that the dog is checked by the vet and paid for by the vet to make sure it doesn't have rabies. Those people who need disability rights upheld in the Charter of Fundamental Rights, that has been scrapped already. We know we've lost the Charter of Fundamental Rights that upholds the rights of people who are disabled. So just as has been said, there's no good outcome for anyone. There's no good outcome for people in your constituency, as there's no good outcome, I believe, for people in my own constituency. But I am concerned about our hard-won rights. And last week we had the Equality Commission and we had the Human Rights Commissions in front of us. And of course, they have got a mechanism, this dedicated mechanism, all this jargon that can confuse people, but they have to watch that to ensure there would be no diminution of rights in the event of us going over a cliff.
So
it happens to our hard-won rights.
So I suppose, first of all, a number of issues to reply to your comments. First of all, it was the EU that set preconditions. They wanted the divorce bill sorted out first, they wanted citizens' rights sorted out, and they wanted the border issue in Northern Ireland sorted out first. I completely disagree with you that it would have been wrong for us to have sorted out the free trade agreement first, because the free trade agreement, you would know what the future relationship would be like, so you would know then how the UK would disengage from the European Union. Secondly, in terms of what my constituents want, my constituents voted for Brexit. I think they would take a very different view from yourself on that. If you'd like to test that, if you'd like to stand for election in East Antrim, then that would be up for you, up to you. Declan has actually already set out where we are in terms of rights, the dedicated mechanism that has been put in place. But again, this will take goodwill on all sides. Some of the issues that you have already commented on there, made reference to, can be sorted out in the dog example that you gave and whatever else it may
blind
be.
Dogs.
Sorry?
Blind dogs, for people who are blind.
Yes, absolutely. Very, very important, and there's no reason why those issues can't be sorted out. We want to see that. We want to make sure that that's going to happen. That's why TO is the sponsor for ECNI, has been involved in discussions around rights with the Equality, with the Human Rights Commission as well. So I don't see why that needs to be a problem or a sticking block.
Well, Chair, I would just say it's probably a lack of understanding of Article 50 of the EU, because that says you can take account of, but you can't set the future relationship. So Article 50 was quite clear. It's EU law. I know that people aren't really now supporting upholding international law, but it was international law, Article 50. If you were leaving the EU, then you have a withdrawal agreement and then discuss the future relationship. That's set in law. But I suppose we're in a territory now, or a moment in time, where people aren't really upholding or supporting upholding international.
Well, you know, I would just like to say I think that the member has shown a complete lack of self-awareness when he talks about upholding the law. Because it was the member who was a member of an illegal organisation. It was the member who had served time in prison. It was the member who, not more than a few months ago, found herself in the position where she was breaking regulations that this Assembly and this Executive has set. So I'm more than happy to have the debate in terms of international law, but I think it's hypocritical of the member to come to. I understand testing your patience, but
point
with
that Chair, issue. I need to be able to respond to that, because we all have come from a past, and a war, it's a terrible thing. It's how you get out of it and how you build conflict resolution. And I would say to yourself that this is about how we discuss sharing a different Ireland going forward. Of course, look, we can all talk about incidents of what happened in the past. And if that's the conversation we want to have, then the Chair, I'm sure, will facilitate that. But we are now talking about the future. And that's what I'm talking about, and that's what I have worked every day since I have been released from jail, to make this place a better place, so that no one either feels that they have to make a decision and choices that I made. So let's move away from that and let's work together to build that better future.
Certainly for all the talk of divorce, it feels like a certain amount of relationship counselling has been going on between the three of you as part of that section, but I'm going to move on because we actually are into our next evidence session at this time-wise, but we have Trevor that would like to ask some questions.
Thanks, Chair, and thanks, gentlemen, for your presentations. Hardly uplifting, but at least it was interesting. Just on what you've just been talking about, and I don't get involved in these things, because I take the view since I came here in 2007 that everybody around this table is here for the same reason, because they got voted. They got the mandate from their electorate, and they got voted into position here. frankly, within reason, what has happened in the distant past it's not really relevant anymore here. We need to move on. I totally agree with what Martina said. But having said that, is it fair to say that the Internal Markets Act won't come into force until we know whether or not we're going out of Europe on a no deal or non-negotiated or crash out, whatever you want to call it? It's cart before horse. We will know by the 15th of October, I think, from what you said, that whether it's Britain's intention, which it clearly is, to drag out the negotiations to the point where he can say, no, we're getting nowhere, we're just going to crash out and make our own arrangements. Now, would that then make the Internal Markets Bill or Act irrelevant? Because if Britain's going its own way, it can make its own rules within reason. And the things that are in the Internal Markets Bill at the moment, that at least more than half of us disagree with, and so does civil society. But they wouldn't be necessary. I mean, and also in terms of the Internal Markets Bill, do the devolved administrations have to agree to this? I see a letter in our papers here from the Welsh Government asking that question. And also, maybe not a fair question for you guys perhaps, but is it a fact that the House of Lords, because this bill wasn't in the Conservative manifesto, could actually block it? There you are.
Right, okay. Where to start with all of those questions? Well, obviously I think that what the government have said is that this bill is to try and create a safety net. In the event that there isn't an agreement, in the event that the protocol isn't implemented in such a way that protects us, these provisions will come into force. So that's obviously meant as a safety net, that type of a mechanism to ensure that is protected.
I'll share with you, Trevor, a quote from the House of Lords Constitution Committee, which is written to Boris Johnson, Michael Gove, Dominic Raab, British Attorney General, and Robert Buckland. And it has said that the Internal Market Bill proposes to confer ministerial powers that conflict with international law, the Ministerial Code, and the Cabinet Manual in Britain. And it cites in its letter, quote, "The Internal Market Bill puts the entire withdrawal agreement and other related agreements at risk, potentially unravelling the policy of the Withdrawal Agreement Act 2020, and this would have far-reaching consequences." So that's coming from within the British House of Lords.
Yes. Well, does it give any clue as to whether they actually think that it could be blocked? It would be unprecedented, but could it be blocked by the House of Lords?
But it gives no clue. I'm just sharing that quotation with you, because I said earlier in my remarks that I think that there are differences of opinion within the British political system, within the Tory party itself, within the British House of Lords. But is there sufficient critical mass within all of that opposition and concern to then bring forward a block to the legislation? I don't know. I don't have a crystal ball.
And it's fairly obvious. I mean, if there is a crash out, that irrespective of whether we have an Internal Markets Bill or not, the effect straight away will be on the north-south border. Has to be. I mean, Europe will not take this lying down. And there's a clear contradiction of our Good Friday Agreement and all the other agreements we have over the years, that the free access to and fro across that border. That will become a European border, and this is outrageous what's going on. I've been predicting here for some months, as you know, that inevitably we're going to get to this point. That was before I ever heard of the Internal Markets Bill, but it's getting worse. And in the back of what Jerry and Doug asked as regards preparations, I don't see any evidence. Not that I would be privy to the sort of information you're privy to. I see no evidence whatsoever of any serious preparations for what is not is now an inevitable no-deal Brexit. It's just not happening. Maybe now, let's be fair, at our local level, perhaps. I think you did indicate there was some preparation going on. But what about national level, where it really matters? We're entirely in the hands of the national government here. Where people have talked about this Northern Ireland being a pawn in the game. Absolutely, that's what we are. Boris Johnson and his Tory government they're not really interested. We're a side issue in all this. I don't think they care much about the Good Friday Agreement, which your party never signed, Gordon, fair enough. And they're just relying on their majority to get through whatever they like. And hang the consequences. They actually think that they can still develop in these circumstances, despite the warnings and the damage to their international reputation as a result of what they're doing now, that they can still strike a trade deal with anybody they like. And what have they got so far? A tiny increase in what's available from Japan, which is not as good as what the EU has, and probably some of San Marino, I don't know, what, God knows where it is. Sorry, I'm ranting.
No, that's okay. Maybe I could come in and answer some of those questions for you. So first of all, on the House of Lords issue, my understanding is, yes, it could ping back and forward between the Commons and the Lords. I'm not an expert on the legislatures, but that could bounce back and forward in that regard. In terms of North-South trade, the UK government have made it clear they're not going to be putting in any infrastructure in the border, so that will obviously be...
The pressure for a border control on the Irish border will come from the EU.
That will be up to the European Union.
It still happens as a result of the activities of our government.
Well, I'm still hoping that there will be goodwill on all sides so that we can prevent that from happening.
I could see that.
And, the other issue then, just on preparedness, yes, there is... the Executive Office does oversee cross-departmental working in terms of... possibility of a non-negotiated outcome, and like I've already said to the Chairman and to Mr. Beattie, we will endeavour to get you more information on that, and the committee will obviously be furnished with that information next week whenever the officials come as well.
Okay.
Listen, I understand where you're coming from. There's a lot of uncertainty around here at this moment in time. I'm hoping that an agreement can be found, we can have a trade deal in place so that we can do away with a lot of these problems.
I'll finish there, Chair, but I might say I'd be interested to see the expression on Her Majesty the Queen's face if she's been asked to sign a bill into law which is clearly in breach of international law. That would be an interesting picture to have. I know she can't refuse.
Okay, thank you very much. Trevor, no other members have indicated that they wish to speak.
Oh, sorry. Emma. I was trying to catch your air. Thank you both for your presentation. Following on from what you had said there about the conversation that was had around preparing and within the Executive Office, the fact that there is a difference of opinion, and obviously then you referred to the Good Friday Agreement and the constitutional question and the fact that the principle of consent relates to that. How do you square the fact that the North didn't vote for Brexit?
Well, the... referendum result was taken on a UK-wide basis.
But we're talking about the North.
So
majority of the people. So if we're talking about we're talking about the rights that are going to be affecting people here and people that live along the border and all the different things that Martina referred to there, and a majority of the people in the North didn't vote for Brexit.
So. We've made it clear time and time again that we want to get an agreement so that those issues don't become issues, that the fears that have been expressed don't come to fruition. Look, we knew whenever we voted in the referendum in 2016 that there was one question and that the result would have been on the basis of whoever got the most votes across the United Kingdom. That was always what was going to be the case. Whereas we have in the agreement a very established and clear way of how things are changed. It's very clear that the consent principle applies, not to whether or not we stay as members of the European Union, but whether we stay as members of the United Kingdom, is very, very clear that any change that takes place within the Assembly on who makes our rules, who makes our laws, there's the consent mechanism that is built in terms of cross-community as well.
Yeah.
So we knew whenever we were voting that we were voting as one nation, and that was going to be the result.
Whereas you've referred there to the principle of consent, and you're talking there about potential division down the Irish Sea and the impact of the Internal Markets Bill and how that was against the spirit of the Good Friday Agreement because of the principle of consent.
Mm-hmm.
But that has only arisen as a result of something that the people of the North didn't vote for.
Yes, but it was always going to be the case that we were voting in a national referendum.
You acknowledge there that there is sort of an inconsistency in what you're saying.
No, because there is no consent here. We haven't even been asked the question here
about whether we want
the border in the area. Because people have made the comments that in some way that it's the that Brexit does damage to the Good Friday Agreement. It doesn't. We are still a member and will remain to be a member of the United Kingdom. We took a vote on that basis as full members of the United Kingdom. Your vote was worth as much as anybody else's.
Well, the North didn't vote to leave the EU.
Yes, but the UK as a whole did.
But yeah, there are going to be impacts for people in the North. And when we're talking there about a land border, that impacts people who live here.
And what I'm saying is that I don't want to see any borders. I don't want to see anything that stops trade north, south or east, west. And that's what we are united on here as an executive. And that's what we want
to
achieve.
There are definitely difficulties.
I don't think that we're going to come to...
No, we're not. But I think there's a lack of sense in referring to it in one instance and not acknowledging that we, you know...
And I'm saying that and I'm saying the same principle.
Okay, we're straying into the territory of a conversation rather than all conversations being through the chair, please, and one person speaking at a time. That helps certainly those that are taking the notes to be able to understand what's happening. So I think we bottled out that we're not going to get agreement here, but
yes,
points are being...
Chair, can I just ask one more question?
Yes.
It doesn't relate to that. So you're talking then, obviously I know you have met the Derry Chamber of Commerce. And the constituency that I represent, Mid-Ulster, has a small area across the border. Are you going to be talking to business groups in the other council areas in terms of people that are impacted on the border region?
So I suppose at the last meeting we agreed to Ms Anderson's request
that.
To meet the group from the Northwest, and we've probably got ourselves into the situation now. We're going to be meeting all sorts of groups from all your constituencies. Look, engagement is something that is a big part of what we do in relation to Brexit. I'm more than happy to continue to do that. I'm sure Declan is as well, and if invitations are sent in, we will of course consider them.
And positively so, because part of the weekly business when we deal with EU exit affairs specifically addresses ongoing engagements that are being carried out by other ministers, by other departments, by our own department. And that particular engagement was very instructive. But we're engaging with the labour movement and other business organisations on an ongoing basis, and would have no difficulty meeting with business organisations, labour organisations, agricultural producers from any of the counties in the region, Antrim, Derry, Fermanagh, Armagh, Tyrone. Happy to do so.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to go now to George, who's indicated that he would like to ask a question. Go on ahead, George.
Thanks, Chair, and apologies for my listeners as well. Just a very brief one, time limit just at the moment, but I just want to support my colleague, Junior Minister Lyons. I think he's been very, very clear and given very, very clear answers here today, and congratulate him on everything that he said, and I agree entirely with Gordon. One small point that I would like to bring to the committee. From the virus's point of view, could a second wave of the virus, could that affect the future outcome?
In relation to the negotiations?
Yes.
In relation to that, we should carry it in there. In relation to the negotiations, for the second wheel, do you think is there any possibility that that could affect the overall outcome?
So, George, certainly it has affected the nature of the meetings. They've had to, I suppose, they took a more online basis than meeting in person. However, I think the government have made it clear their desire to get this finished. And I don't think even a second wave would limit the work that needs to be done to the point where this would be pushed back any further. Obviously, it's too late now anyway for the extension. So I think it is the 31st of December is the is that obviously 15th of October has been mentioned as well. So I hope that we can get to that point where it's finished, because the most important thing. Because as and I think that's right, George, because as you know, what businesses want is certainty, and we need to give that certainty to businesses, which is why I hope that we can get that agreement in place as soon as possible so businesses can prepare for whatever needs to come after.
Thanks very much, Chair.
Okay, thank you, George. Trevor?
I suppose in terms of what George had asked and Gordon's response, I'd say it makes an interesting thing in terms of where we are at. And I mean, I suppose in terms of where Duke's been at and questions been asked about what next and what the planning is, but is there a financial package to actually stimulate business on the other side of this?
Yes.
And what does that look like?
There has been funding that's been made available. I don't have the exact figures here, but through the Business Support Service, I believe there was a sum of money made available to try and help businesses to transition during that time. Trevor, yeah.
155 million, I think it says.
155.
Okay. Junior Ministers, I know you look forward to coming to visit us, and I hope that was an enjoyable enough session. We appreciate your answers. We did take a little longer of your time than we anticipated, but we appreciate that it's a very complex issue and that the answers can be quite detailed and that there are varying views in the Chamber and also within the Executive Office, so that can take a little bit longer to present them, but we certainly appreciate you coming along. There are a number of follow-ups, not least that if next week we have those officials in about the readiness for a no deal, if they could be well prepared and we don't get officials saying we need to go back to ministers and clarify that for you, if we could get that information, it would be appreciated. Thank you very much indeed. Members, we're going to take a raise for a few minutes because we need to prepare the chamber for the changeover in our guests. So if people want to take 2 or 3 minutes while we prepare for that, thank you. Okay, you're welcome back. We have the room cleansed and sorted and ready for the next guests that are in. We're going to move on to a discussion about the Victims' Pension Scheme. Members, on page 110 of the meeting pack are the relevant papers, page 21 of the table pack for the departmental briefing paper, which was received late, but we did get it circulated to members on Monday morning. The officials are in attendance today to brief us on the latest position in relation to the Victims Payment Scheme, and I'd like to take the opportunity to welcome Mark Brown, the Director of Strategic Policy, Equality and Good Relations, and to Gareth Johnson, the Director of Equality, Victims and Human Rights in the Executive Office. As usual, we are recorded and being broadcast live at the moment, just to make you aware of that, and maybe we'll pass to yourselves to give a presentation, and then we'll take some short questions from members afterwards.
Okay, thanks very much, Chair, and thanks for the invitation to be here today. I'll just give a brief update based around the briefing paper which we provided on the Victims Payment Scheme. I think the first point to make is that both the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister are entirely committed to delivering the scheme. And on the 24th of August, the Executive Office designated the Department of Justice as the department to exercise the administrative functions of the Victims Payments Board on the Board's behalf under Para 2.1 of Schedule 1 to the Victims Payments Regulations. The Office also agreed to provide grants to the Department of Justice to establish the administrative arrangements for the scheme. And this will allow for the recruitment of board members, IT developments and the other steps that are necessary to establish the board. The Justice Minister has indicated to the Assembly that her aim is for the scheme to open for applications in early March. There's a substantial programme of work is underway with DOJ, and TEO officials are meeting regularly with DOJ compensation services and have discussed their respective responsibilities and input to the implementation of the scheme following the designation of DOJ as the department. And this regular liaison will continue throughout the implementation of the scheme. The Lord Chief Justice expects the funding issue to be resolved promptly, and in anticipation of a formal appointment, he has made a judge available to help with the development of the scheme. And DOJ officials are liaising with the Northern Ireland Judicial Appointments Commission, NIJAC, on the details required for job descriptions, terms and conditions, the numbers and the complement for the appointment of board members to enable the appointment of board members to progress. TEO and DOJ officials are also engaging with a potential assessment service provider on the design and development of an assessment methodology. The discovery stage of the IT solution commenced on the 21st of September, on Monday, and this will include exploring ways of ensuring that the application's interface is as intuitive as possible for people who are making applications. In terms of evidence gathering and information sharing, TEO and DOJ officials continue to engage with all the relevant bodies. This includes the drafting of evidence gathering protocols and service level agreement and information sharing agreements for the consideration of the board. Officials have also had a number of meetings with sector representatives, and discussion will continue on a fortnightly basis for the foreseeable future, in order to ensure the sector is fully informed of developments and has the opportunity to input as implementation progresses. In relation to exceptions, the Secretary of State's guidance on exceptions was published on the 14th of August. Turning to funding, it's recognised that there remain significant challenges which will need to be overcome in order to successfully deliver the scheme, including the adequate funding for the duration of the scheme. And in accordance with the normal government budgeting arrangements, a request will be made for the necessary funding set out in paragraph 9 of Schedule 1 of the regulations with the Department of Finance as the need for that funding falls due. The First Minister and the Deputy First Minister, along with the Finance Minister and the Justice Minister, will continue to seek additional funds for the block grant from the Secretary of State and through him the Treasury to address the financial pressures created by the scheme. And this is in accordance with the Treasury's Statement of Funding Policy. A meeting between the First and Deputy First Minister, Justice Minister and the Finance Minister was held yesterday on the 22nd of September to agree the approach to be made. In relation to costs, it's difficult, as we've discussed before with the committee, to estimate the cost of the scheme with any precision, given the uncertainty over the number of applicants who may come forward, and in particular the numbers with psychological injuries and the extent of those injuries. And whilst the initial estimate of 2,000 recipients was based on figures on victims and survivors in contact with existing services, and total numbers could significantly exceed this, the fact is that there's no comprehensive record available of all of those who were injured in troubles-related incidents. So officials are pursuing further information in relation to those who may have been severely psychologically injured in a troubles-related incident with a consultant psychiatrist at QUB. And this work is still in progress, but it suggests an estimated figure somewhere between 3,500 to over 7,000, some of whom will be double counted in the initial 2,000 estimated figure. So work is ongoing to scope out the figures regarding the number of individuals in Northern Ireland who are in receipt of injury pensions from the armed services. And officials are currently finalising detailed scoping work to model the potential range of costs, which will then be used to inform the administration of the scheme going forward. So that's just by way of introduction, Chair, and we're happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much for that presentation and information. I suppose, you know, this is one of the most sensitive and at times and in places controversial elements of the work that you're doing, but it is one that is needed to be progressed, and there needs to be a movement on it. I suppose some of the issues that you've raised in your paper there, you mentioned that the Justice Minister has said that she hopes to have the scheme up and running for March of next year. But I suppose the question is, like, how can you prepare and have something and say that something will be up and running in March? What will happen if you don't have the funding? Will it, I mean, can you progress everything up to the point of this is how much you'll get, but we don't know how much money is in the coffers to hand out, or, you know, how much of the process will take place in the absence of knowing what money is available?
Well, clearly, Chair, the first, as I said, the First and Deputy First Minister have made it clear they're committed to the scheme, as has the Justice Minister, and also that the any request for the funding required will be made as it falls due. In other words, as the costs, the anticipated costs start to become necessary and to crystallise, the Department, the TEO, will bid through DOF for the funding that is required. £2.5 million has already been made available this year to allow the initial preparations to be made to have the scheme in place. And we'll be working with the Department of Justice to help them to put in place those arrangements to ensure that, as far as possible, the timescale set out by the Justice Minister of March for, in terms of opening for applications, is able to be met.
But, I mean, and again, I appreciate there may never be answers to some of these questions that I'm asking, but from the executive's perspective, on the hoof isn't exactly an awe-inspiring answer whenever you say, how are you going to prepare for the money that's needed? I mean, does that mean you get to the end of 1 month and realise you need £5 million, so you go and ask for it? The next month it's £20 million, you ask for it? I mean, where do you ask for the money from if it exceeds the money that's in the pot?
Well, the intention is to seek the money from the Department of Finance in accordance with the normal government budgeting arrangements. So we're coming up to a budgeting outlook of 3 years, where the need for funding will be set out by all departments over the next 3 years, and the executive will have to consider what allocations can be made. As part of that, there will have to be estimates put in for the costs of this scheme. And then, of course, the executive will have to make decisions about the funding that's going to be made available in light of all the bids and requests that it has received. So that's the process, and ministers have agreed that the necessary costs will be put forward as part of that process. If it turns out that allocations are made and either all the funding isn't required in any 1 year, or indeed the opposite, that some additional funding is required, the normal monitoring arrangements provide for additional bids or indeed easements to be made, and it would be as part of that process that the department would seek the funding for the scheme.
But quite often those normal monitoring rounds generally are for, we need an extra million for this programme, an extra £3 million for that, or sometimes in health it can be a little bit more significant, £20 million for that. This overall scheme could be running to hundreds of millions of pounds that are extra. And, you know, there's normally, in the experience that I've seen from I've come here in terms of monitoring round, there tends to be around about somewhere between 80 and 100 million that's available that has to go right across the whole executive. This programme has the potential to zap up all of that money for the next number of years, that nobody would be able to get anything else if you just use monitoring round funding for it. Would that be a potential outcome?
Well, there's no doubt that this scheme will create financial pressures, which will have to be dealt with and considered alongside the other financial pressures. And that is why the First and Deputy First Minister, and indeed the Finance Minister, have made it clear that they will be seeking from the Treasury, through the Secretary of State to the Treasury, additional funding to the block to help to defray some of the costs associated with this going forward.
And of course, that additional money, is that based on there being 2,000 recipients or 7,000 recipients, depending on? I mean, that's quite a variance. So how do you prepare a bid for something that's so vast in terms of the estimates?
Well, we are currently working in the Executive Office and working alongside DOJ officials to scope out the costs and get greater degree of understanding of how the costs might arise and what the range of those costs might be. We will then have to make our best estimate of what the likely numbers of people coming forward are likely to be, and also take into account what the likely pace of determinations and decisions might be, because it's only when determinations are made that the actual costs crystallise, other than administration costs, the ongoing administration costs. So we will have to make judgments around that. But that is where the flexibility that's in the system to bid within a year and either to bid again for more or to ease if those assessments aren't in line with what actually happens in terms of the determination. That's where that flexibility comes in.
I think, you know, the British government legislated for this. They pushed it forward and have left us in a scenario where we're having to open a scheme without knowing how many people can apply for it, and then we have to pay for it, is where it is at the moment. So I think that just leads us right back around to saying that the British government should be making a substantial contribution to this scheme because of the scenario that it's left us in here. Just finally, a very quick one. You said in your report, and you did mention it in your updates there, that the Lord Chief Justice expects that the funding issue to be resolved promptly. Does he have some inside knowledge there, or that's just his expectation, is that it's solved promptly?
Well, I think the Lord Chief Justice is working on the basis that the First and Deputy First Minister have made clear that they will seek the funds from the Department of Finance, or through the Department of Finance, in line with the normal procedures, and on that basis, when the funding is there, he will formally appoint the president, and he has already identified a judge who's working with us on some of the details.
So it's his wish that it's promptly, rather than he knows it's going to be promptly.
Well, I think it's his hope and expectation. But yes, he doesn't have any insight.
There's no inside track there that
Okay. Not that I'm aware of.
Okay. Good response at the end. I'm going to pass to the deputy chair, to Doug.
Thanks. Chair, and thank you, Mark, Gareth, for being in front of us here and giving us this. It is contentious. We know it's contentious, and we'll all have our views on it. The board members, I didn't catch it. I think I might have just missed it. When do we think they will be set by? When do we think we will actually have the board members set up and ready to start sort of making sure they're trained in, ready for this to start?
Well, there's already work ongoing with NIJAC to work through the detail of the job specifications and the processes for recruiting board members. The Justice Minister has said that she would hope that the scheme can open for applications by March. I think the expectation would be that the board would be in place to receive applications and be able to make determinations as soon as possible after that. We don't have a precise timetable as yet around that, but we would hope it would be as soon as possible after March.
Right. Okay, so it wouldn't be aimed to get them in before March so that they can be a board and be trained and go through it?
And that's certainly the basis on which Department of Justice and NIJAC are working. It's a different arrangement in this legislation from we had in the HIA legislation, where the Chief Justice appointed the judges and then the Executive Office appointed the other members, which maybe gave us a little bit more flexibility. In this legislation, these are all judicial appointments. They're all done through the Judicial Appointments Commission, that has an impact on the timetables. But certainly the aim that we're talking to NIJAC and working to is that members would be available in advance of that go live for applications, so that they could settle the things like the policies for the board and so on that need to be settled in advance.
And I think to give confidence as well, I mean, people will be looking at the makeup of that board, who's on that board, and we need to make sure that our whole society have confidence in regards to that board as well. I'm not going to touch on the money side of things. I think the chair covered that quite well. And what I would say is I'm absolutely in agreement that the UK government should be stumping up a sizeable chunk of this, you know, because it is a UK-wide scheme and victims are right across the world, including Canada and Australia and other places. But I would remark that because of our failing in the Assembly, that's why Westminster had to do this in the first place. You know, that's why legislation came through Westminster and not this place here, is because we weren't here. So I think it's slightly unfair to just blame them on that. But the last point, can I just ask this one on information sharing? How does it work if somebody comes before the scheme having been involved in something in the past, terrorist-related, and applies for the scheme and divulges information as part of his application form? How does the information sharing work in regards to the police? Will that information automatically be sifted by the police to make sure that there's no new evidence from crimes past.
Gareth, do you want to pick that one up?
Yeah, there is discussion that has started with police about evidence gathering protocols and what exactly those look like. Now, my expectation is, and certainly in the conversations we've had with the sector about the format of an application form, that people would be invited up front to disclose if they had a conviction that needed to be taken into account under the terms of reference of the regulations. Yes, I would expect that will be subject to some kind of check. It is grounded, the exceptions are grounded in convictions and various kinds of convictions that people would have, the Department of Justice obviously has access to the criminal records viewer, which would allow those things to be checked. So, yes, we anticipate that there will be some kind of check as part of the eligibility.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, Pat.
Okay, thanks, Chair. Welcome back, Mark and Gareth. Don't know how many times it is now. Just on the timescale for early March, I'm slightly concerned, given the complexities of this, that we might be raising hopes just to dice them. Are you confident, Mark, that we'll be up and running, applications will be able to come in early March?
Well, I mean, that's the time frame that the Justice Minister has set out, that she's hopeful that it can open for applications at that point in time. And in our discussions, and we've obviously been in close contact with the Department of Justice officials, and we will continue to work with them closely on this. You know, we've looked at what the requirements are around the scheme and looked at some of the experience we had with the HIA in terms of setting up a similar type board and some of the processes and the time it took. And all of that's fed into, you know, that broad assessment in terms of time frame.
Are you optimistic?
Sorry?
Are you optimistic we'll hit that target?
I think that target is achievable. I think it's a challenging target. But I think it's one that we will do our best to achieve. And again, we can open for applications, and we'll want to be able to make determinations as soon as possible after that. But it is possible that there might be some further processes that need to be put in place after the applications open. Not everything might be completely in place from, you know, from start to finish, but I think that we can still work towards that time frame for opening for the applications.
So is there a possibility there could be a fairly lengthy time lag between the receipt of applications and the payment at the end of the process?
Well, there's a whole range of factors come in there, Pat. There's will all the arrangements actually be set up? Will the board all be there in place and all the processes all agreed? And we'll be working with all the necessary agencies trying to make sure that is the case. But in order to make a determination, an application has to be received. It has to go through, be checked for the eligibility in terms of a trouble-related incident. All those other aspects of whether any exceptional circumstances apply have to be worked through. And then there has to be, if necessary, a medical assessment, potentially, depending on whether or not there's been what records have come in with the application. And then it's at that point you can make a determination. So it's a whole process that has to be in place to allow that to allow determination to happen. Now, some cases will be more complicated than others. We would expect, as again was the same with HIA, and in some cases there are victims who have very extensive records, medical records or other, who are in receipt of services and who will be able to put in an application that will be relatively straightforward for the panel to consider and to make a determination on. So we'd expect that there would be a number of those that could potentially have early determinations. On the other hand, there could be others where maybe all the records aren't there, or including the medical records, or where there are difficult decisions around eligibility, and some of those will take longer. So I think it's just, you know, it depends on the application and depends on the amount of information and on the systems, the appropriate systems being
in place. And just going off on a wee bit of a tangent, in terms of all the discussions that are taking place around this process, What engagement is between the NIO and the Executive Office, the victims' teams?
Well, we had engagement at an earlier stage when we had an oversight board and NIO were represented on the oversight board. The extent of that engagement now that the legislation is in place has reduced, but we are still in contact where we need, for example, to try and get some information, if there's any information that they might have, or advice on how we might get information. For example, we wrote to the NIO recently just to find out about how many military there might be in receipt of a pension, and to get more information around that pension. So we do have some ongoing contacts like that, but in the main, it's now ourselves and DOJ who are taking forward the delivery of the scheme.
Okay, could I move on to the situation in regard to the courts, and has there been any discussion around how the courts will interpret the NIO guidelines? And I suppose also what impact the remarks of Brandon Lewis will have on the issue around the independence of the board, his assertion that the British government reserves the ability to exercise a power to intervene and seek reconsideration of decisions by the board.
Well, the guidance, as you know, was drafted and finalised and agreed by the Secretary of State, and it was the NIO that determined that, and the President of the Board will have to have regard to that in reaching his determination. So he will have to look at that guidance and interpret that in an appropriate way. In relation to the comment by the Secretary of State, my understanding is that the Minister of Justice has written to the Secretary of State asking him for clarification around that point, and we await a response on that.
And is there any discussion around how the courts will be impacted operationally, you know, in terms of the appeal of decisions and so on? Has the Lord Chief Justice any fears that the system could be adversely impacted by this particular scheme, given the lack of clarity, I suppose, around the guidelines and Brandon Lewis's utterances?
Well, part of the process that the board will have to go through, as indeed HIA had to go through, is looking at its processes, looking at its procedures. They'll have to look at the guidance and come to an understanding of how it believes that guidance needs to be interpreted and applied. And that will be something for the President to do. I don't know if you have anything further on that.
In terms of appeals from individual decisions, they would be dealt with by the Victims Payment Board itself, by a different panel within the Victims Payments Board. But there is always the possibility, as there has been until now, of challenge, judicial review challenge. Whether that is of the Secretary of State or of matters closer to home, but certainly in terms of appeals in individual cases, it'll be the board that'll deal with those rather than the wider court system.
Okay, and just finally, Chair, I wanted to discuss the design and development of an assessment methodology. I was wondering if you could flesh that out a bit, and particularly. I was wondering what role victims groups in particular would have in all of this, because I think it's probably essential that there's co-design and co-production in this whole process, because nobody knows the victims sector better than the groups that are represented, groups like WAVE and RFJ and so on. So, for example, what role do those practitioner groups have? And, for example, have their premises been considered as assessment centres? And will there be any sort of quality assurance and oversight of this assessment methodology when you take account of all the difficulties there were in the likes of PIP and the complaints there were and the number of cases that were overturned on appeal and so on? We don't want to go back down that road again. I know there's a lot there, but I'd like to hear your views on it.
Okay, you've been on the detail list. Yes. You want to just pick that one up?
Yes. There is a certain amount of the assessment methodology that is already available, because the scheme mirrors a lot of the aspects of the industrial injuries scheme, for example. So there is material there. There's a handbook on industrial injuries that we will be able to borrow and to use. I think that will be is probably better spelled out in terms of physical injuries, which is what people in industrial injuries most often experience. I think it will need some more fleshing out on psychological, where there are broader indications of the different levels, but the what exactly falls, you know, 14% to 20%, 20% to 30% and so on, needs some more work. Department of Justice and ourselves will be working. The plan would be with Capita to develop this assessment scheme and then to roll it out. In the discussions that we've had up until now with Capita, now we're not yet, DOJ isn't yet in contract with them, but in the discussions that we've had up until now, this point about what have you learned from PIP? And how do we bring the victim's focus that is written into the legislation as a key principle, the need to prioritise and be responsive to the needs of victims of trouble-related incidents is the first of the principles that the board has to have regard to. So how do we do that is one of the key areas we've been discussing with them. They have been open about what they've learned from the PIP experience with liaison with VSS and with victims and survivors groups, and are very keen to be able to bring that to the way forward and to consult with groups as part of that. We, in the meantime...
Sorry, just to stop you a second. There's a difference between consultation and co-design, and are you saying they're just going to consult?
Well, I think people will bring, different parties will bring their respective expertise to that. So in terms of expertise on psychiatry, we would expect psychiatrists who have been working with us to bring that. In terms of expertise in trauma and how do you make something trauma focused, we would expect the victims and survivors groups to bring that, and in respect of how do you run an assessment methodology and what kind of practical issues do you come across, then Capita will bring that to the party. So I think we can bring all of those aspects together into the design of this, and you know, respect the contributions that different people can make.
And just a final short question. Thus far, we don't have any sort of concrete figures or estimates about what this scheme is going to cost or how many people are going to benefit from it. When can we expect to see something in black and white?
Well, we're currently still interrogating the figures, and as I said, we have written to the NIO to get a contact on the MOD to get some sense of the war pensions. How generous they are compared to victims' payments, to see whether or not anyone who's in receipt of that would be likely to claim, or indeed whether their spouse would be likely to claim in the event that they pass away, and to help us to clarify that area of uncertainty, and the same in respect of police pensions. So there are some uncertainties there that we need to clarify, and then we are continuing to work with the psychologist at psychiatrist at Queen's just to get a better sense around the numbers there. So I would hope that over the next 3 to 4 weeks we would be in a position where we will be getting the best estimate that we're likely to get. I made the point before to the committee that the reality is here we're never going to get an estimate that's going to be right. We're going to get our best estimate, and as numbers start to come in, we might start to refine that estimate because experience will tell us that in fact either more or less from certain categories are going to come in. But we've looked at all the different client groups that are eligible. We're looking at the range of levels of numbers that might come forward. We have to make assumptions about the average level of award. There's a lot of moving variables in here, and as I say, we will end up with what will essentially be a table, which will have a number of assumptions down one side and a number of costs across it. And in light of that, we will make what we consider to be our best central estimate. And we'll put a lower and a higher. We've done that with HIA. We have to wait to see whether that's going to be right or not. And we don't know yet about that. But we'll do that with this one. And we will then have to... The other thing is going to be quite difficult, actually, even when we get to that central estimate, is profiling each year's actual financial requirement, because that depends on the numbers that come forward, when they come forward, and what the characteristics are of those that come forward, and also whether they go for lump sums or whether they go for the long term. There's a lot of things in here that are quite tricky, but all we can do is make the best estimate that we can, bid for the appropriate funding, and if that funding turns out to be too high or too low, adjust through the normal financial processes I described earlier.
What do you think you'll have your best estimate in 4 or 5 weeks?
Well, we're working to try and get that within that time frame, because we realise that with an opening date of March, we need to be able to give ministers the best information that we can for them also to approach Treasury around the detail of the funding that they might provide.
Okay, thanks for that. Okay. Thank you.
Emma?
Thanks, Chair. I just have a short question. Thank you both for your presentation. Again, just around the evidence gathering, information sharing aspect, obviously a lot of the people that would have been involved in incidents during the conflict and people that perhaps suffered police brutality or got caught up in the middle of a riot or something and didn't report it at the time because of the nature of the place at the time. What has been done to counteract that decrease in reporting retrospectively?
The board will be open to all the evidence that someone can bring, and it's not the case in the legislation that if somebody didn't report something at the time, that then they won't be eligible. So in that sort of situation that you've mentioned, there might be medical records, either contemporaneous or maybe of medical treatment that people have sought since, or there, you know, there might be other kinds of records. We're working on drafting up for the board's consideration an evidence gathering protocol, which will probably say, okay, for starters, you go to police and see if they have records. And if there are records there, great, case moves on. If not, maybe you go to the health service. If not, then you look at, for example, other published sources, newspaper accounts, those kind of things. So there will be a protocol to be gone through. And there will be support for people, and we're talking to Victims and Survivors Service about what exactly that looks like. There will be support for people in getting the evidence together, and we're looking at how that can be delivered through the existing Victims and Survivors groups. So support for people in getting it together, but you know, ultimately the board will look at whatever people have and whatever they're able to gather. It doesn't have to be from any particular source.
Okay. Trevor Clark.
Thank you. Thanks, Chair, and thank you both gentlemen for your presentation. I suppose we're united in something in terms of possibly who the paymaster is here in terms of UK Treasury. But the thing that strikes me difficult for this one, of course, is that it's been a long road, but we still haven't quantified a cost. And I'm wondering how you go with the collection plate to Westminster saying, we need you to pay, but we don't know how much it is. We don't know what you to put in this tray. I actually think the credibility of the work, I mean, I don't mean this personally, is it towards you, but the work you have done in terms of your credibility will be diminished by the fact that you actually haven't got those answers. Because I think we're all collectively saying Westminster should stump up the most, if not all, of this money. But we don't know how much that is. We're hoping to open the scheme in 6 months, but we don't know much to ask for. And I think in response to some of your questions, or your responses today have been useful, except I think some of that work could already have taken place. because the records that the police and others would have held in terms of numbers with pensions was already there. And I'm wondering why some of that wasn't quantified. And in your own words, you've talked about best guests, best estimates previously. And I'm just scratching my head and wondering, 6 months out, there is a debate about who pays. We're all collectively saying who should do it, but we don't know how much to ask for. And what I fear is that they actually may pay something, but it will be terribly short from what they should be paying. So at what stage is the real figure going to be on the table that the real ask comes about?
Well, probably a range of points to make in response to that, Trevor. I think the first point is that in terms of having a clear estimate, the expectation would be that the body and the organisation that was bringing forward the proposal should actually cost it. In that case, it was the NIO, and it should have been the NIO who should have costed this. And should have looked at the business case and brought forward a business case which would have set out the costs, the benefits and so forth, and then we would have had the figures from the outset. So that is why we are coming from behind to try and make up ground in that regard. Now, there were some estimates done by NIO on the basis of the 2000, but our belief on that is that is well short of what is likely to come forward. So we have been trying to make up the ground on that, building on that 2000 figure. And I explained earlier on, we would hope to be able to move this on in the next matter of weeks, because this is going to be a negotiation with the Treasury, and in going to the Treasury, what we want to be able to provide to ministers as best we can is a breakdown of how the costs emerge from the various client groups and how they might come forward in terms of the numbers and so forth. So there can be then some discussion around that. And there are different ways in which I'm not going to get into the detail of how that negotiation might work, but there are different ways in which that can be done. There are some uncertainties about the numbers that might come forward, and there can be an argument about what costs the Treasury should actually pick up. But we're going to try and break down the costs as best we can and put that to ministers, and ministers can then decide how they want to engage with the Treasury around this. As you say, it's difficult to know what figure to go for if you're not certain about what the outcome might be. So whether you go for a figure or a category or a group in terms of who picks up the costs is, again, part of the negotiation. But all of this has to be worked through and decided. All we can do is make the best estimate with as much breakdown as we can, set out the range, and then ministers will have to make a judgment as to how they engage with Treasury on this.
In terms of NIO, I mean, I appreciate that one, Mark. Yeah.
Sorry, George. Ironically, we're going to Westminster and making a case to Westminster, but some of the information that is needed to do that, the executive doesn't have, Westminster has. So that'll be part of our discussions.
That's fair enough. In terms of the board, the structure of the board, and did I pick you up saying running costs of $2.5 million, or did I miss something there at the start?
The two and a half million is the amount that's been made available through a monitoring round this year in order to allow the initial setup costs for the rest of this year to meet those costs.
What do you see the annual cost then?
I wouldn't like to speculate too much on the annual costs at this stage, because it depends on the numbers that we predict and what the flow in those is going to likely to
tell
be.
You what, because
it depends.
Just go ahead and give us your best estimate.
It's
well, there is a bit of chicken and egg in this, as Gareth is alluding to, because if we know there's lots of numbers coming forward, we'll have to look at how many panels we need. And you might want more panels to try and increase the flow. So there is a bit of chicken and egg as to what you would do.
Mark, with the best respect, you have to have a number there, because there's a budgeting process in terms of, I mean, we're not going to get off scot-free here. We're going to have to do something on this side. So you have to have a number there.
That's part of what we're working through with the Department of Justice, as I say, and part of the work that we're doing around these overall costs that we hope to have sorted in the next matter of weeks will be costs which will include the administration.
And do you know what size this board's going to be?
That'll depend again on the numbers of throughput that are anticipated. What we might do.
Sorry, can I
and we've had
now?
This.
How can it be driven by the throughput if you hope to have the board in place before the applications go out?
Yeah,
because that's contradictory.
Maybe that was something I should have clarified earlier, and apologies. A board this is similar how we did things with HIA. You can establish a board which can make the decisions that are necessary to open the scheme with a smaller number of people. Because as long as you have got your president and you've got at least one legal member, medical member, ordinary member, you can establish a board with that. You can then add to that board as cases start to come in and as the number of cases start to increase and you need more panels. So on HIA, we started off with a small shadow board that was able to make decisions, and then fairly quickly we added in further members to that who've been dealing with the cases. So we're planning for that small board, but as to how many additional appointments are likely to be needed, that will depend on the estimates that Mark's been talking about.
So the small board you talk about, how big is that?
It would be something that will need to be discussed with the president. Potentially, I'm thinking between 4 and 7 people, probably.
And remuneration for that?
Is a matter that the Department of Justice is responsible for, because it, in the legislation, is required to set the terms and conditions for board members. And I understand it's currently considering that and in touch with NIJAC.
And where would you, in your best estimate, again, where would you reckon that would be?
I wouldn't, again, like to speculate, because it's not the Executive Office's responsibility under the legislation. It's for the Department of Justice.
Okay.
Trevor? Yeah, thanks. Just on the question of potential payments and the lump sum versus pension. Would it be right in thinking that first of all, your claimants would have the choice, presumably, which they want to go for. In terms of the calculation of the benefit, would it be the case that you would calculate an appropriate pension first, and then extrapolate from that what the lump sum would be, and that would, at some extent, be based on life expectancy? Is that fair?
Well, it's based on the pension, but it's based on rolling it up for 10 years, and the 10 years lump sum being available, 10 years worth of pension, sum being available, and no further payments after that.
That's already.
And that's when you reach age 60, or if you're terminally ill.
All right. Just in terms of the funding, the Minister for Finance seemed to be in no doubt last week with the answer to a question that's been answered now. To me about the funding, and he's in no doubt, as far as he's concerned, it all falls to the NIO, and he quotes chapter and verse to justify it. It's something to do with whoever instigated the legislation. So,
yes, I think he was referring to the statement of funding policy, which was agreed between the Treasury and the devolved administration at the time devolution happened. Essentially that says that a policy-making department is responsible for the costs of that policy.
Thank you.
Okay, George, you're looking to ask a question there?
Yes, sir. Thank you. And thanks to Mark and Gareth for the presentation. Just one quick question. The board that's to be set up, will there be medical personnel on the board? Would you reckon?
Yeah.
But more or less to distinguish, you know, people that has put in an application from a medical point of view, that someone from the board can assess, you know, that those hopefully innocent victims.
Well, there's two aspects to this, isn't there, Gareth? The first one is the determination of eligibility. And that's where in particular, the expertise is around determining whether someone is eligible for a payment. When it comes to the medical aspect, it's a requirement on the board to have an application assessed by a medical professional, and that's where the medical assessment that Gareth talks about comes in. So that medical assessment is done through whatever names is put in place there, and at the minute we're talking to and Justice will be talking to Capita about that assessment. So that medical assessment will come through that route, unless, of course, there are existing medical records that are that the applicant makes available with the application that can determine the medical requirement.
Yes, and just from Treasurer's point of view, I personally think that they should be put in the bill, quite honestly, because in the block grant that we get year in, year out, there's always a cut on it. And whilst I welcome these victims at long last getting a payment, it's long overdue. I think that Treasury and NIO should be putting the bill for it.
Well, that's certainly a view that's shared by the Deputy First Minister and the First Minister and the Finance Minister and the Justice Minister. Yeah. So fairly widely shared view here locally.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, George. And that brings us to the end of the presentation. And look, I think we're all aware that yous have been left to implement the scheme, and there are a lot of outstanding variables. And the only way that we're going to be able to work out what the overall financial package that's required is once those variables are in place. And of course, the difficulty is we want to secure as much of that funding as possible from another source, and that requires us to know what the numbers are, and we can't work out the numbers until we know what the variables are, and we don't know what they are. But the fear, I think, that's probably being sort of articulated here today is that under all of this is that if we don't get that funding from the British government, it's going to have to come from the block grant, which means that we're going to have to make cuts to health and cuts to education and cuts to other sources at the present time. And that's a real fear, and it will create a difficult situation in the delivery. So there's a lot of information that needs to be worked out and progressed there. All we can do is wish you well with that and hope that we can get some more information. I think we will ask you to come back again at a point in the future, because I think it's important that we track this and know exactly what the ramifications are and where the progress is in the delivery. So thank you very much indeed, and we'll give you a moment or two to leave before we progress on to the next items.
Okay, thank you very much, Chair.
Thank you.
Okay, members, we'll move quickly through the last few items. We have the Forward Work Programme that is available at item 6, which includes that next week, for example, we have officials from the TEO discussing the monitoring round, and as we mentioned earlier, we have some TEO officials in on the contingency planning and preparation for a no-deal Brexit. Are members content to note the Forward Work Programme?
Yeah.
Okay. Correspondence this week, item 7. There is one item in the correspondence meeting pack and one in the tabled pack. One is in the tabled pack. It's item 7.2 at page 26 is correspondence from the Committee of Procedure on Procedures. The committee has agreed to extend the temporary provisions contained within standing orders until the 31st of January. The motion to extend will be considered by the Assembly on Tuesday the 29th of September. The committee is asking for any views in the temporary provisions and potential amendments. Does anybody have any overriding views that they wish to articulate to that committee, or shall we allow our silence to indicate that we're happy with those? Okay. Can I jump on that? Yeah, so we're content to note the rest of the items in the... fine. Okay, item 8, Chairman's Business. I just want to take this opportunity as chair of the committee just to say that I absolutely and utterly deplore the threat that was issued to yourself, Doug, as you're a vice chair of this committee. We all know that there's absolutely no place in our society for violence. I know that you are steadfast in calling that out and calling out any criminality and any behaviour that you see that is inappropriate or doesn't stick to the law. And I'm sure that the members of this committee would stand shoulder to shoulder with you on that, and we just say there's no place for that type of threat. Just to update members as well, myself and Pat met with the EU ambassador to the UK last Thursday and had a conversation with him It was pretty much in line with what we've heard to date. There was nothing too major about it, but we just reiterated a lot of the concerns that would be raised at this committee. And finally, in room wars, we are next week, unfortunately, not going to get access to the chamber. We have to move back to room 30. That will have two ramifications. Number one, it's going to bring us back to the 2 o'clock start, which means that we won't be finishing at near 6 o'clock. So it's got one positive side to it. But the other is that there isn't a great amount of room for the full committee there. Now, I will investigate over the next week and keep members updated to see if it's the potential for officials, if they're presenting in groups of about two, that maybe they could come in via the Starleaf and that they could actually be on the screen and we can interact with them with questions, and that might allow extra members into the room, because the members are going to be there for the full meeting. The officials that are coming in are only going to be coming in for one item and then leaving. So it might be better for us to have more members in the room, but we'll work and see what the capacity is for that over the next week. But we will be moving to 2 o'clock and it will be in room 30. Any other business from any member allows me to once again say that the date, time and place for the next meeting is next Wednesday at 2 o'clock in room 30. So members, thank you very much indeed for your attendance and participation.
Nyland Assembly, Senate Chamber, programme signed. This is